Well, good morning. Christos Anesti, if you're from Cyprus or Greece, Pharistor. This is an amazing passage, Jonah chapter 3, to speak on this day in the Christian calendar, if you're on, of course, the Western calendar, because we celebrate today the Lord's resurrection. And if there is ever a time for there to be joy, excitement, celebration, and a hint of triumphalism in the Christian faith, it's today. The rest of the time, you can look like you normally do. Someone once said to me, "Michael, when you speak about Jesus, let your face shine like an angel. When you speak about hell, your normal face will be just fine." And so I would like to start this morning, actually, by giving a word of thanks to the translators. And I think we should just acknowledge their hard work. I'm doing this for a simple reason. The next 2 days are just so exciting in terms of what the scripture says. The speed is likely to go up rather than down. And so I'm praying now they'll remember this moment with gratitude and extend the grace that was extended to Jonah and to Nineveh to me. So we're now in Jonah chapter 3. And the next 2 days, we're going to be getting down into a lot more depth of the actual text. Because the book of Jonah is split into two sections, and it repeats itself. If you have the book of Jonah open before you with your Bible or in your handbook, you can see it very easily. In Jonah chapter 1, verse 1, the word of the Lord comes to Jonah. In Jonah chapter 3, verse 1, the Lord of the word comes to Jonah a second time. In chapter 1, verse 3, we see Jonah's response to that word. In chapter 3, verse 3, we see Jonah's response to that word. In chapter 1, verse 5, we see the non-believing response to that word. In Jonah chapter 3, verse 5, we see again the non-believer's response to that word. Do you see how it parallels all the way through? And at the end, of course, the end of chapter 2, we have God's response to what has happened. And at the end of chapter 4, we see again God's response to what has happened. There is this beautiful poetry in the book of Jonah. And we're about to read of the greatest single revival that we read about in Scripture. It is on a scale just not seen anywhere else. So it's hard not to be excited about it, very excited. But we also find it hard to believe. Now, why? Well, it's partly because of what's just happened in Jonah chapter 2. In Jonah chapter 2, Jonah is swallowed by a giant fish or a whale. So how can we believe that? Did that really happen? And if that didn't happen, how can we believe the revival in chapter 3? Maybe that didn't happen. As we would say, as English theologians would say, this story about a big fish, it's a little bit fishy. You can't really trust it. And the reasoning would go like this. We're people of science. We understand science. We don't believe in myth anymore. We believe in truth. And this cannot possibly happen. Now here, we have quite a big contradiction in our culture. Because our culture is normally saying two things at the same time. Number one, I cannot believe in a God and in a book that tells miraculous stories like this. I cannot believe it. Number two, I will only believe in God if he does a miracle to me now. Now, you can't have both of these. You cannot say, I will not believe in a God who does miracles, it's not believable, and at the same time say, I will only believe if you do a miracle now. You're going to have to choose one of those two. So we're already caught in a contradiction in our culture. Now, one of the people I have the privilege of working with, another more senior member of our team, is called John Lennox. Have any of you heard him speak? I love listening to him speak. If you have never seen him, watch him on YouTube. Unlike anyone else I've heard, when he's preaching, you want to walk up onto the platform and give him a cuddle. He is just so gentle in everything he says. John and I had the privilege a few years ago of being in South Africa together. And we were speaking at the University of Cape Town, which is one of the leading universities of South Africa. And we were also speaking at other meetings in the city. And the meeting at the University of Cape Town was large. As a matter of fact, the head of the university said it was, who had been there for quite a long time, he said it was the largest ever gathering meeting they had ever had that he had been, well, since he had taken over the university. It was so well attended. Can we believe in a miracle performing God today? And as we left the auditorium, you walked into a huge corridor with these big concrete walls. And while we had been inside, some students had been outside. They had put posters everywhere, on every wall, every window there were posters. A picture of John Lennox, and underneath it said, "Don't believe John Lennox, Richard Dawkins." And then they had pictures of Richard Dawkins saying, "John Lennox is not a true scientist. Don't believe him." And then they had other posters saying, "Come and hear a real scientist speak tomorrow night." And it gave the time and it gave the date. Now, John Lennox and I were speaking that next night. We couldn't go to the meeting, otherwise we would have gone. But one of the students said, "I will go and tell you what happened." So the following morning, we met with the student and he started laughing. He said, "You won't believe what happened." He said, number one, 40 people came. Number two, they had invited one of the heads of biology, one of the most famous scientists at that university, actually one of the most famous scientists from the continent of Africa, to give a talk on evolution. He gave a brilliant one-hour talk on evolution. At the end of it, the head of the Atheist Society stood up and said, "But Professor, you haven't explained to us why this disproves the Christian faith." And the professor stood up and said, "Well, it doesn't. That's why I'm a Christian." Now, the problem was the students had believed Professor Richard Dawkins too literally. He had said, "If you are a great scientist, you must be an atheist." So the Atheist Society said, "Who is the greatest scientist in our country?" And they found him. They didn't ask him what he believed, because they must assume he must be an atheist. It was a lovely moment. Now, here we have to think very carefully. Supposing I were to take my notebook with my sermons in, and I were to throw it in the air, the notebook would fly in a beautiful parabolic curve, and because I know science, I can predict where it will land every single time. If I know the velocity at the moment it leaves my hand, and I also know the angle of departure, with mathematical certainty, I can predict where the book will land every single time. So let's suppose I throw my book in the air And it flies up and then it just stops. Midair. I don't look at it and go, wow, the law of gravity is being broken right now. It normally applies, but obviously it doesn't apply. That's not what I say. Something I cannot see, or someone who I cannot see, is applying an equal and opposite force in the opposite direction. That's why it's hanging there. How do I know that? How do I know that someone has intervened? It's not because I don't understand science. It's because I do understand science. I know how science works. The book should drop. If the book doesn't drop, I can reliably conclude someone has intervened and done something. How can we tell when God has intervened in this world? It is because we understand science. It shouldn't happen that way. The fact it's happened differently allows us to say someone or something has done something here. That is how we know. Now, we sometimes talk about the miracle of Jonah being swallowed by a big fish. This is not a miracle. People have been swallowed by giant fishes in history, and they have been removed from those fishes, but they are dead. So getting swallowed by a giant fish is not historically unusual. I mean, it happens not frequently, but sometimes. And there are some amazing pictures online of these big fish if you want to see them. But they're dead. But Jonah is swallowed and he's not dead. So the question is, who has intervened to stop it? And how do we know someone has intervened? It's not because we don't understand science, we do. He should be dead, but he's alive. It's exactly the same about the resurrection that we celebrate today. People didn't believe in the resurrection 2,000 years ago because they didn't know science. They know dead people don't come back to life. That doesn't happen. When you're dead, you're dead. Everybody knows that. So the fact that Jesus was dead and is now alive, the question is, who has intervened and done something here? How is this possible? The early disciples believed that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, not because they didn't understand science. They knew the science well. The question was, who has raised him? It is because we live in a mathematical world that acts with regularity, we can tell when someone intervenes. Now, there's a difference between though what happens in chapter 1 and chapter 3. In chapter 1, the sailors believe in God because they see a sign, they see a miracle. Jonah goes into the sea and the sea goes quiet. But the people of Nineveh do not believe because of a sign, because of a miracle. They don't see Jonah swallowed by the whale and vomited onto the beach. Okay, their city is hundreds of miles away. The people of Nineveh are not converted because of Jonah's experience. They are converted because of the power of the Word of God. Jonah's authority to preach does not come from his experience and his testimony. It comes from the power of the Word. So you may be sitting here saying, I would like to reach my great city. The biggest city near here, I think, is Frankfurt, right? Okay, so you may pray, Lord, I will reach Frankfurt just like Jonah did. I will throw myself into the sea. You send a fish to swallow me. When I come out of the fish, I'll tell everyone what happened, and then they will believe, right? But that's not what Jonah said. Jonah doesn't share his testimony with them, but testimony is powerful. He shares God's word with them. And that's the most powerful thing of all. It changes everything. Have any of you ever done evangelism where you go and you knock on someone's door, they open it, you say hello, you smile, I'm from this church, my student group, we've come here to tell you about, and as soon as you say Jesus, the door closes, very often. If you've done it, you've experienced it. Imagine if God loaned out angels to help with door-to-door evangelism. So imagine God sent to you the Archangel Michael. Now, some people think Gabriel was an archangel. But Gabriel doesn't have that title in Scripture. There is only one angel in Scripture who was given the title Archangel. His name is Michael. I want us to be clear about this. So God lends you the Archangel Michael for a week. You go to the first door. They open the door. Hi, we're here to tell you about Jesus. The door begins to close. The Archangel puts his foot in the door. An enormous size. A white light shines out of him, and he slowly removes an angelic fiery sword from his side, and as he twists it slowly in his hands, he says, I would really like to come in. Well, that would do it, right? And actually, the answer is, well, we know what the answer is, because Jesus himself told us directly. Jesus directly answered this kind of situation. You can read about it in Luke chapter 16. Jesus said, there was a rich man who everyone would assume is being blessed, and a poor man who everyone would assume does not have God's blessing. He's poor. And they both die on the same day, Jesus said. The poor man goes to heaven, which is very surprising. And the rich man, who is surely being blessed, he goes to hell. And then the rich man looks up to heaven. And his first request is, please, can I come and join you up there? It's nicer accommodation, better weather. And they say, that's not possible. His next request is, okay, can you send the poor man Lazarus to me to give me water? I'm dying of thirst. And the reply from heaven is, that's also not possible. It is fixed. You can't cross from one to the other. It's one-way entry. When you're in, you're in. If you know old songs, it's like the Hotel California. You check into one of those places and you never leave. So then, the rich man says, please send Lazarus back from the dead to warn my brothers. I don't want them to come where I am. And the reply from heaven is, they have Moses and the prophets. They have the word of God. Let them believe this. And the rich man says, they don't believe this. But if someone comes back from the dead, they will surely believe. And the reply from heaven is, I tell you, even if someone is raised from the dead, they will not believe. Isn't that interesting? A little while later in Jesus' ministry, a real man called Lazarus dies, and he is buried. And Jesus raises him to life in front of everybody. And when this is reported, what happens? Now notice, the people who hear the report don't question the reality of the miracle. They all believe in the miracle. And they say, look at what he's doing now. Jesus is raising people from the dead. If we allow him to continue, everyone will believe in him. So they plotted how to kill him. Isn't that interesting? A sign, a miracle, your hardened heart. The sailors are open to the Lord. They see a sign, a miracle, they believe. The Ninevites are open to the Lord. They hear the word of God, they repent. God has given you this most powerful, incredible word. I love hearing stories of what God does, miraculous, and in one sense, every conversion is a miracle. God does something amazing. But the authority that Jonah had in his preaching is available to you. It's the same word, the same Lord, the same Holy Spirit. He can work in all of you. So Jonah finally goes to Nineveh. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. It's so gracious. God doesn't say to Jonah, Jonah, you messed up last time. This is your last chance. Or God could have said, Jonah, you had your chance. Now it's someone else's turn. He could have said all kinds of things. He doesn't do any of that. He just speaks to Jonah again, go. Being an evangelist is not easy. There are times in my life when I've known great blessing and times when I've known great difficulty. I remember years ago now going to London to speak to some university students at one of London's top universities. And I was so tired. I'd been traveling a lot. I was feeling tired. I got on the train to go to London from where I live in Oxford. And all the way on the train, I was angry. Angry with God, angry with myself for saying I would go, angry that I was having to do so much, angry that I was still going all the way down. As I got ready to preach, I had to repent and say, Lord, please don't let my anger stand between you and them. And so I preached to them. And about 18 another group came up and said, we are all children of have no faith. Can we talk to you some more? I talked to them for 3 hours. They thanked me a lot. There were tears. I missed the last fast train to Oxford. I had to take the slow train to Oxford. It took 2.5 hours. You could walk faster. This is the difference between British trains. And I was so angry on the train. On the train, you would think I'll be like saying, God, you're amazing. You're incredible. Wow. But I didn't say that at all. I was angry, and I was angry that I missed the train. And the next morning when I woke up, I knew something had to change in me. That is not the appropriate response to seeing God work that way. And so I've known very hard and difficult times. I've also known some times of incredible joy. I remember not long after this, I was preaching in London again, very international church. And I was speaking twice in the evening. And in between the two services, they came to give me a cup of tea. And the lady who gave me the tea said, I've heard you preach before. I said, really? And you still came? She said, yes, you were in my country a few years ago. And she named the city, and I immediately remembered what happened, because it was quite unusual. It was a guest service. They invited non-Christians to come, and they said, if you are a guest, stand up. We want to welcome you. And I can remember thinking, this is a bad idea. Anyway, 22 people stood up. And at the end of the message, 21 of them became Christians, which is amazing. The church was only 200 people in it. So I was so excited. So I said to the woman giving me the tea, I wonder what happened to the 22nd guy. Do you remember 22 stood up at the beginning, only 21 gave their lives to the Lord? I said, I was so disappointed. I was joking, okay? She looked at me, she said, would you like to meet him? I said, you know him? She said, I'm married to him. I said, I would love to meet him. So she goes off, she comes back with her husband. I say, please have a seat. He sat down, I said, what happened? He said, from the moment the gospel started being proclaimed, I felt like I had to stand up and say, I believe. And I was terrified. He said, so I held onto the sides of my chair, pulling myself down for the whole time you preached. And then when you asked people to stand up, I was fighting like this the whole time. And after everyone had left the church, he was still in his seat holding it. One of the leaders had to come to him and pull him out of the chair. They thought there was something wrong with him. For the next 2 weeks, he said, I couldn't sleep. I had almost no sleep. And after 2 weeks, I emailed the pastor. I said, I have to meet with you. And we met for breakfast. He said, I look terrible. And I said to the pastor, I can't run away anymore. I have to become a Christian this morning. That's a great story. So how is it possible to experience that? And then a little while later also experience the opposite. The incredible thing about the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, is it's not dependent on you. You don't make the gospel powerful. The gospel is powerful. God can use you. It's his message, his word. He can change and indeed does change people. So Jonah is now about to go and preach his message. And the drama you saw here was brilliant this morning. Because, as we will find out in chapter 4, he doesn't want anyone to respond to his message. He's an evangelist who wants to see no one saved. And the message he preaches has a beautiful ambiguity in it, a beautiful double meaning. Because he says to them, 40 days, and then everything will be overthrown. And that word in Hebrew can have one of two meanings. Number one, Sodom and Gomorrah were overthrown, completely destroyed, annihilated, wiped off the face of the planet. But the same word is used to translate the phrase to turn upside down, to reverse everything. So you have the same word used in the book of Deuteronomy, in chapter 23, verse 5. For the Lord your God turned the curse into a blessing for you because the Lord your God loves you. It's the same word. God turned it. He made it upside down. It was a curse. It's a blessing. So when Jonah says 40 days and everything will be overthrown, it means one of two things. Destruction or revival. Jonah possibly hoping for destruction. And we'll see this very clearly tomorrow. The people, however, they hear the possibility in the message. In this sense, Jonah is preaching prophetically. What he says, everything will be overthrown, will come to pass. Everything will be turned upside down. It will. Now, when we think of prophecy, we think about telling the future. But that is the minority use of the word prophecy in Scripture. The majority meaning of the word prophecy in Scripture means to interpret the times with authority. Read Ezekiel, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Amos, pick any of the prophets. What do? They interpret the times with authority. They say, you want to know why it looks like this? It's because you did this. And you want to know why everything is going this way? Well, it's because you decided to go and do all of this stuff, which is wrong. But if you repent and turn, God will hear you, and it can change. And in this sense, we desperately need a prophetic declaration of the gospel today. A gospel that interprets the times. Have you ever heard an adult convert give their testimony? Very often, they'll say something like this if they were converted in church. They will say, it was like the preacher was preaching only to me. It was like there was no one else in the room and he was speaking just to me. Have you ever heard that? What are they saying? That this word was interpreting my life, what's going on in my heart, in my country. And then when I heard about Jesus, it made perfect sense. We need this declaration of the gospel afresh in Europe. And last night, if you were here, we have a lot of reason to be hopeful right now. Now, we read that the message is proclaimed, it's God's message, not Jonah's. And then we read that there is total repentance. From the greatest to the king to the least. To every man, to every beast. There's another beautiful poetry in the Hebrew, which is why we had the sheep here. Even now, he is not saying, the Bible is not teaching animals need to repent. Sometimes people ask questions, will my dog be with me in heaven? The answer is not, well, according to the book of Jonah, they must repent, fast, and then they can be saved. That's not what this is teaching. It would be like the author of Jonah saying, even the grains of sand repented. Does that make sense? It's like saying everything, from the greatest leader to the poorest subject, all the way, okay? Everything, everyone, turn to the Lord. That is incredible. If I had preached this message and I had seen this, I can promise you one thing. Every time I preached, no matter what country I was in, I would tell this story. Okay? I would be telling it all the time because it's an amazing story. Leaders are often very hard to see repent. Leaders are often very heavily defended. And it's very hard to admit that you're wrong. But imagine what our politics today would look like if leaders from time to time addressed their nation and said, I was wrong. I'm sorry about that. We won't do it again. We're going to do something different. Would that make things better or worse? But we all know how hard it is to do this. And so in this story, we have another play on words. The great prophet who experiences a great storm and gets swallowed by a great fish and preaches this great message and sees a great repentance, sees a great king come to his knees and give his life to the Lord. But what's happening in the prophet's life? Is the prophet actually great or small? Well, you have to come back tomorrow to find out. So don't read chapter 4, otherwise you'll ruin the end of the story. And there's another parallel. In chapter 1, the sailors say, perhaps if we repent, God will forgive us. Or who knows, if we do this, maybe he will hear. And the king says the same thing. Who knows, if we do this, maybe things can be turned around. King David says the same prayer when his son is dying. The sackcloth, the ashes, he fasts and says, who knows? Maybe the Lord will be merciful to me. And the king uses this phrase. There's no presumption. He's not assuming it will happen, but maybe it can happen if they truly turn away. And then the next thing we're told in the passage is that they believed. And this is another great word. It's a fantastic word. It's the same word used in Genesis 15, chapter 15, verse 6. Abraham believed the Lord, and it was accredited to him as righteousness. Well, if you know your biblical history, Abraham believing the Lord changes all history. It's the same word used when Israel is delivered at the Red Sea. The Red Sea is parted. And after they cross through, we read in Exodus, and they believed the Lord and his servant Moses. So when it says here, they believed, that's the word they use. It doesn't mean to believe ideas. It's more than that. It means to totally trust a person. So if I were to say to you, or if a friend were to say to you, do you believe in me? What are they saying? Well, when they ask that, do you believe in me? They're saying, do you trust me? And you trust people who you're sure about. They're trustworthy. It's a complete reliance on God. Not belief that God exists. They completely throw themselves on him. It's an incredible thing. I was speaking in a country a few years ago. I won't be able to give you the name. I met with some people who'd become Christian the year before in the same country from a different religion. And one of them was telling me about his experience. He'd become a Christian, and a week later, his friend said to him, okay, now we go on mission. We do a mission week, an events week. We now do evangelism. So they went to a city, and the guy started preaching open air. The police came. They beat him to the ground with their sticks. When he was on the floor, they picked him up, two men, one on either side, by his hair, and started shaking him like this. And the hair came out of his head, and he fell on the floor again. And as he was telling me this story, his pastor was sat next to him. And the pastor reached over and removed the skull cap from his head. And when he took the cap off, you could see these two bald patches either side of his head. And then they threw him in prison. Now imagine if this was you. There was an events week at your university. You become a Christian. 1 week later, they say, okay, your turn. You get beaten to the ground, they pull out your hair, and they throw you in prison. Would this discourage you? So they throw this guy in prison, 1 week old believer. What does he do? Well, he looks around, and he notices there are 40 other people in the prison cell. And they can't go anywhere. He literally has a captive audience to preach to. Now, he's only been a believer for 1 week. He knows a couple of psalms, he's memorized some of the gospel, and he knows a few songs. So he says to the prisoners, can I sing to you some new songs I learned? So they listen to the songs. Then he says, can I tell you what I'm singing about? So he quotes the psalms, he quotes the gospel, he starts preaching to them, he preaches all through the night. At 7 a.m., he is still talking to them about Jesus. And the head of the jail comes into the prison. He unlocks the door, points to this man, and says, I am throwing you out of my prison. You are a troublemaker. Now, this is the most unusual excuse I've ever heard for not locking someone up. And as he walks towards the door, one of the men grabbed him and said, you cannot leave until you tell us how we can know Jesus too. Some of us in this room are scared of evangelism. We're scared of mission. Because we think we may feel embarrassed, or people will make fun of us, or they won't be nice to us. We're going to meet some people in heaven. We're going to have some very interesting stories. Some of them won't even have hair. And believe me, our excuses at this point will not sound very convincing compared to theirs. When you know how much you have been forgiven, how deep your sin is, how gracious God is, and how much he has forgiven you, you have to tell everybody else. You have to. It's the most logical thing to do. And at the end of the chapter 3, which is where we're coming to, we read of two great turnings. Or three great turnings. The Lord turns everything upside down. We read the people turn from their evil ways. That's one verb. And God also turns. It's a different verb. Now, sometimes we translate this, God repented. The trouble with that translation is that today, when we talk about repentance, we only mean repentance from sin. But classically, the word repentance also means change of heart. What it literally says in verse 10 is they turned from their evil ways and God turned to them in compassion. So as they turn to him in hope and sorrow, he turns to them in compassion and there's forgiveness. And everyone's saved. A huge city. Now, I would love to see revival on this scale. I'm sure you would too. But think about this for a minute. There are a couple of thousand people here. Between us, we go to hundreds of different churches. We're at hundreds of different universities. And hundreds of little events organized every month with just 10 guests in them. Across all of us is going to equal about a couple of 100,000 people. That's more than who were saved in Nineveh. lots of little things added up together make for a very big total. Yesterday I told you about my friend John Bechtel. Today I'd like to close with one last story from him. John's family was one of the last missionary families to be forcibly expelled from China. There was a great cleansing, all the missionaries were pushed out. So against his parents' wishes and the family's wishes, they were now in Hong Kong taking refuge. They were refugees. He grew up there, and as he grew up there, when he went back, he wanted to do something for the children who had nowhere to go in the summer. He started praying that he could have a camp. And he started looking for buildings where he could build this camp. And eventually he found the perfect place. It was an abandoned school. It had dormitories. It had sports facilities, swimming pool, playing fields. It could take thousands of people at a time. He wanted to buy it. An American was visiting. The American said to him, "This is an amazing vision. I'm going to go to America. Give me 3 months. I will raise all the money you need." 3 months later, John got a letter in the post. When he opened it, there was a second letter inside. He read the first letter first. It said, "Dear John, things have not gone as well as I hoped. Only one person has given a donation to buy your camp, and it's from a 12-year-old girl. I enclose her letter." So John now opens the second envelope, and in the letter is a note from a 12-year-old girl. "Dear Mr. Bechtel, please use this money to buy your camp. This is my pocket money. I'd like you to have it. Much love, Belinda Holmes." And in the letter was $1 bill. He was so angry. He was angry with the guy who sent him the letter. It was like he was being made fun of. And his wife said, "You need to do what's written in the letter." The girl said, "Use my money to buy the camp." So the next day, he went to the caretaker of the building. He said, "I want to make an official offer to buy the whole site," and handed him the girl's letter. The guy opened it, laughed, and threw it back at him. John said, "By law, you must pass on every offer to the owners, otherwise you can go to jail. If you do not pass on the offer, I will report you to the police." So the caretaker was like, "Oh, okay." 2 weeks later, the owners met. They read the letter, and they were so moved by it, they sold the site for $1. Now, <laughs> 20 years later, John was telling this story in a church in America. And after he finished preaching, as everyone was leaving, a lady about 35 years old came up and said, "Mr. Bechtel, my name is Belinda Holmes." It was the first time she had heard what had happened to her dollar. John spoke to the pastor. He said, "Go outside the church and get everyone to come back in and then lock all the doors." So they went out and they got everyone, "Come back into the church." They gathered everyone back. And John introduced them to the woman who was a 12-year-old girl, had helped set up a camp. John said, "Why don't we take a collection to pay for this woman, she's not very rich, to go and see what her money did." So they took a collection. They raised enough money to send her, her family, and half of the British Army back to Hong Kong. I wish John could be here in person to tell you this story. Because a few years ago, they decided in Hong Kong to have a reunion of all the people who came to Christ through that camp. There was a newspaper helicopter that took an aerial photograph of the stadium, and you can see 120,000 people there, all giving thanks to God for the ministry that had happened through this camp. You may be sat here this morning thinking you have very little to give, but it's amazing what happens when you put very little into the hands of God and do the small amount you can. And when you add all those little bits together, God is able to change the world. And we desperately need him to see him change this continent again, which is lost without hope without him. But in the gospel of Christ and through his cross, as we'll hear tomorrow, we have a certain hope that changes everything. Can I pray for you? Father, on this Resurrection Sunday, we come before you. Lord, we have nothing to give you that you haven't given us. Everything we have has come from you. And Lord, may our complete trust and belief be in you. Lord, where we need to repent of our own unbelief, may our repentance be as deep as that of the Ninevites, Lord, and as real as the kings as we heard of today. May our trust in you be complete. Lord, may we take your message, going with your strength and your Holy Spirit, to see this world changed. And it's in Christ's holy name we pray.